Hi, my name is Phil Maguire. I live in southern Leyte in the Philippines, in a township called Pabdre Burgos Long Sadaan. I run a dive resort and have done for since 2005. We started the dive resort. I did it with a British guy called Ron Parks. Him and I just both passionate about diving and also the environment, especially the marine environment. So we built, this was his house existing, and then we built the cottages and another annex apartments up the road. We've been running the dives, so I've been running it since 18 years now, I think, or thereabouts. Anyway, our major goal is to help with the marine parks, and we've been pretty heavily involved, or I have especially, with the marine parks and getting them implemented in the bay, which has been pretty hard. Maintaining them, and maintaining them, people set up all these marine protected areas and pretty much don't do a lot. We try and protect them from predators like the crown of thorn, starfish. We're instrumental in designing a crown of thorn gun to eliminate them underwater, which works very well, and it's less manpower, and you can control most of your reefs with this, or we've found that. In the last, I don't know, probably 15 years, we've killed probably over 1 million crown of thorns in our time. So we have been doing a lot of that structure. Then anyway, so since then, my business partner died, and I took over and run it pretty much with my wife, Pedro, and Annalyn. They're all part of So Good Bay Scuba Resort, which is a company. Someone banging over there. My business partner passed away, so I had to take up the realms, and we've pretty much kept the same staff for 18 years or thereabouts. Each one of my staff are divers, and they're also very well versed on the marine and side of it. Most of my staff now are dive masters. We also do, we've been trying to help the community in a lot of ways, my wife especially. She does, when the typhoon hit us, she did all the, a lot of people sent goods and money to us, because they trust us and they know we've been here a long time. And my wife and a number of community members all pitched in and gave food for all the people that needed it during the time of the typhoon. I mean, I've been through 3 typhoons in my life, big ones, so I am well, you can never be over prepared. And we had quite substantial damage to the resort and our house and apartments. So that's been quite a financial hardship on us, and then having the pandemic on top of it. I mean, I always say this to foreigners who come to our country or to the Philippines, is one thing is it's all very well to have hardship in the West, but hardship in third world countries is just so much worse, you have no idea. And the governments and so forth, they react far later than Western countries. But anyway, we've moved on, and one of my sidekicks, as I said, I've designed a crown of thorn gun with Pedro, and also helped with the So Good University has been helping us do it, and I've patented it now, and hopefully we'll be able to sell it overseas as well. It's a far cheaper one than pretty much everywhere else. So I've been making a little bit of money on that now, and that's been pretty good. Anyway, moving along, we do. As I said, we do marine protected maintenance and looking after it, which includes the crown of thorn starfish elimination or eradication, and also we do coral restoration. And I've been doing this jointly with the Southern Leyte provincial government. I have some friends there, and also with a guy called Jerome from Southern Leyte University. He's a marine biologist. So we've put together a sort of a plan, and we've been doing this for many years anyway, but we've sort of put this, and we're building we lost our house reef, or the top of it anyway, to about 5 meters from the Typhoon Odette. So we're trying to restore it. And what we do is we've got a number of methods. My method, which I've been doing for many years, tried and tested, is fragmentation coral planting, where we collect broken corals, we let them rest for a couple of weeks, and then we move them to areas where we're planting. And I don't...
You rest them in the ocean, right?
Yeah.
It has to be underwater.
Under the water, yeah. So we have a sort of plantation racks where we make them rest, where we collect them.
So we call gardening in the
ocean. Yeah, it's underwater gardening. Well, I'm not a scientist in any way, shape or form, but I do enjoy... It's my break. I usually do it not every day, but pretty close to every day. And since the typhoon, I've planted about 600 corals already. And you can even start seeing little parts coming up all over the place. It's quite interesting. Another thing that might be interesting too is when you take a broken coral as opposed to a coral that's already fixed and living, the fragmentation coral grows 3 to 6 times faster.
They want to catch up, right?
Well, I don't know. I'm not a scientist. My friend Jerome could probably explain that one to you, but I don't. But yeah, and
they
then
fill up the space. I know that.
My experience too is we have lots of mediums out here, meaning rock formations, which the waves that came in destroyed lots of the corals. However, there are lots of nooks, holes, crannies, lots of little places where we. So I get a coral, say a branching coral of some form, for example, and find a little hole. You put it in the hole, you turn it a little so it's firm. It just has to be firm. It doesn't have to be rock
solid.
You
lock it in.
You sort of lock it in. If you just put it in there, it moves, it won't grow, it'll die.
Yeah, and the waves will
push
it away.
It. The current action and wave action will move it. So you've got to be pretty... And I have around about, over the last, I've sort of around about a 65 to 70% success rate. So yes, some die, but a lot don't. And it's all to do with where you place it. And then I'm well aware of some corals don't go with other corals. So there's many things I know.
They're very competitive,
But it's a thing where you need to dive with me to get that experience. I mean, I can sit here and talk.
We'll do that in the second part of this video.
Yeah, so that's a pretty interesting thing. And as I said, I had in 2009, I had when Arroyo, President Arroyo was... in power at the stage, she gave 1 million peso grant to a marine biologist from San Carlos University marine biology part in Cebu, and they came out and lived here for a year, and I supported them with tanks and so forth for the period of time. So I learned quite a lot from this lady. Her name was Ethel Wage, actually. Anyway, that worked out well, and we planted maybe 200,000 to 250,000 corals in a year. So that was pretty good. And the regrowth was incredible. Once it started, it was quite amazing watching it.
So this is a well-proven method that
yes,
could be
no,
applied
many,
anywhere in the world.
I've been diving since I was 12 and I'm 60 now. So I've probably been doing it, you know, at least for 30 years, this method in Fiji, all over the world. And it works. I know it does. And it's not rocket science. I find, and nothing against NGOs, but a lot of NGOs come into lots of places and set up things. And really, it's a thing that's an ongoing thing. You can't just come in, bang, do it. You have to have people to look after it and to maintain it. There's also another thing, which it's a repeller. We call them vampire snails here. They're in large numbers now after the typhoon, and they bite a coral and they kill it. Especially the smaller ones.
So that's where you inject them with the...
Well, no, I don't inject those ones. I collect them. I just move them out of the MPAs at the moment. You know, there are things... You have to guide a fine line here because, like, MPA, marine protected areas have MPA rules, okay? So you can't take anything from there. I can move it, but you can't take... I look at those sort of things for me anyway. And as the same with corals... I collect certain corals, I don't collect all the corals, and there's lots of broken corals, but sometimes it's good just to leave it there because it's naturally regrowing. But I have areas where I'm replacing. I have a video of all this area here, and we're going to use this area as a pilot scheme for other areas within the bay. So we're going to get this up and running and showing them it works, then bringing in local community members who are passionate about diving, and but the marine side of it, and get them to do it. And also divers. A diver can plant maybe 10, 15 in one dive, not even putting too much work into it. And that's something that
people... So what triggers these broken corals to actually start to grow? Do you have anything for that, or just placing them in a firm place?
It's
nature takes care of it.
Yeah, it's like planting a seed. It's the same principle.
Like proper soil.
Yeah. And as I said, most... You know, you've got to be careful. Like, people take corals and break them. I don't do that. I collect corals that are already broken. There's a big factor between that. Now, I grow corals, so I bring...
How do you know if it's still alive?
Oh, you colour.
Just look at it,
mostly colour, you'll know.
It's not bleached, right?
You know, anchor damage, storm damage, fish damage, many reasons.
Turtles,
yeah, they all have a go. So you can collect these corals and place them somewhere firm for they to regrow. I also do sponges. I also do Gorgonian fans. I plant them all. It's a lot of fun, isn't it?
Yeah,
you watch things come up and you go, oh, I planted that and it grows. It's quite an amazing thing. But my main aim is, you know, people do have typhoons, and normally it decimates 0 to 5 meters, big waves coming in like that. And it is, it's just unbelievable. You go there one day, oh, wow, and then the next day, oh, it's gone. So, yeah, these are the sort of things I want to fix. There's a couple of major dive sites here which are very good for the community and for the dive shops, and we need to start planting them. That's pretty much it. So, yeah.
So just the process, just a few words about that gun that you talked about that you invented.
Well, the Crown of Thorn gun, it's partly, I buy parts from Lazada online and Shopee, and then I put them, we make the essential part, which is the hypodermic type needle, which is made of stainless steel, and we tap them and make sort of something, we make a connection for the existing part, which is a dosing gun or a basting gun that you can buy on Lazada. So we put all that together with a reservoir, a 3-liter reservoir, and I sell one.
And what's the chemical inside?
Oh, we can use vinegar, which is, we use 30, the mixture is 30% vinegar, 70% fresh water, and we mix that in and we inject the crown.
So it's not really toxic, which is very important.
No, and the same, we also use sodium bisulfonate, which is a pool additive to bring the pH level down or whatever. Mm-hmm. We use that as well. And
so you make it acidic?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. That's what affects them. So we inject the bigger ones like this. We inject a couple of times, 2 to 3 times. With the dosing gun is 20 mils. So we inject them into the pad. So there's this crown and we put it into the pad and inject it. 2 or 3 normally kills them within 24 hours. And then they become fish food. It's quite amazing when you go in and you... got a crown of thorn outbreak and the fish will clean it up the next day. The fish are everywhere. It's just amazing. So they do eat crown of thorns, most reef fish here. I don't get what anyone says.
It's the full circle.
And instead of pulling them out and getting stabbed and they have a problem, you have to bury them and they stink. There's so many reasons. I always think that if they could eat them, they'd be a lot better. There wouldn't be many then, would they? But yeah, so that's one of our ongoing programs. And I've done 1 or 2 programs now with the Southern Lady Government province during the pandemic, because the first year of the pandemic, we weren't allowed to dive. Unknown reasons, I don't think you can catch COVID underwater, but anyway, that's life. So we waited a year, and that gave allowed the crown of thorn starfish to multiply in numbers. So they came back and we had massive outbreaks in many places. Anyway, I did a 6-month program with the Southern Leyte province, and yeah, we were able to put them under hand. We killed maybe 200,000 over that time. So, you know, you look at it, in one dive, one diver can kill 150 crown of thorns in one dive. So, yeah.
It's very effective.
Very effective. Instead of pulling them out or whatever, it's much, much easier. Yeah. So I've been selling them to other provinces now and other areas. Up in Manila, I'm selling quite a lot now. So, yeah, it works. I know it works. I've been doing it for a long time. So,
how long does the coral take to regrow, typically? A couple of years?
Yeah, well, to bring it back to what it is, it'll probably take 2 to 3 years here. But to see some sort of difference, it takes 6 months, up to 6 months.
You already see that it's growing.
I already see it now, yeah. Before I went out, and I was sort of, I planted so many corals out, it was pretty demoralising. But, it is what it is. You can't change it. And our business is diving, so we want to make everything look nice again. So I've had many meetings with the Department of Tourism and so forth, and I said, don't go on about death and destruction and what the typhoon is. And forget about it. Move on.
Yeah,
Do not talk much about it, because, A, people think, oh, Southern Lady's been destroyed. It's no point. You don't. Low press profile and just get on with it. Plenty of shots. We take many pictures of all the areas that are still good. And there are many areas still good. You can't just paint the doom and gloom method.
This is a wonderful message for the young generation, I think.
But, I mean, it is. And I've been through many different types of tragedies over my life. And as I said, there's no point sitting on your ass and doing nothing. You get up and get on with it. And so we did. And I had very good support from my local staff, my family really now, extended family. So, yeah, and we managed, like I said, we made monies on the guns and we did money on killing the crown of thorn. So we worked our way out of it financially and, hopefully we get more guests. That's the next thing, but, yeah.
And then we'll see in the second part of this video, we'll see the guns in action and we'll be diving together.
We normally, I'll see whether I can. I have a lady who used to work, I was telling you about in 2009, we had a marine biologist there. Well, her offsider or her diver, she works for me or sort of helps me. She's been doing her dive master's course. The other thing I forgot to mention too, we also do one joint effort, what they call the SPOT team. It's Plonge du Monde. It's a French organisation that comes out every year and trains local divers from open water all the way up to DM. They're coming next month, actually, after 2 years, and so they're finishing off their program. And they do open water to dive master, and they're training a lot of, for example, the rescue teams, Penrose and the agricultural people that are coming in, and we've trained up.
So they come from France and they locally...
They're instructors from France.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so they come out.
But the students are the locals.
All locals, yeah. And my staff have done it, taken on this as well. So it's been very helpful. And they're very good people, very good people. They always, every year they're organised. They come out, they do their thing, and I support that as in logistics and so forth. That's been pretty good. So hopefully, as I said, this year and then the following years. What they do is they train young guys who, and hoping they'll work in the dive industry, because there's a lot of people who dive who aren't qualified or they aren't this or they aren't that. They do it the paddy way. But, it's a pretty good thing, I think. So I support that wholeheartedly, And the other two things we do... we also have two other methods, a hanging method where we use fishing line, thick fishing line, and we hang corals off there, especially branching corals, and they grow really well. Then we replant them. So we grow, catch little ones.
Like an incubator.
Yeah, thing. And they grow, and then we cut them off the lines, and then we go and plant them in different areas. And then one more, which we're trying to be involved with, it's what they do is it's clay. Clay which has been fired, and they're like giant pizzas. They're flat topped like
a table.
I've
seen them in Dumaguete, similar,
and
big
then
barrels.
You plant all the small corals within.
There are holes
it.
Inside.
Yeah, and what they've found is clay reacts very well with the corals, much better than most substrates or mediums that we use. So it binds
you
better.
You love to bond to it.
And grow much faster on all these things. So I have a friend, Ned Gagravas, who's he's the one of the guys in the province who runs the pottery shop in the province. So
he's making now these
We're making
for you,
these
right?
ones. And we're doing that with a Hong Kong organisation who have sort of pioneered this. They make it with 3D computers. So it's a lot more high tech than what we do, but they've given us quite a lot of support, and that's been quite helpful too. So yeah, and one other thing too is we lost a lot of reef, but the fish still stay there. It's amazing.
You know, it just like, went deeper during the storm and then came back.
Yeah, and then
back,
now they've all come up, and now all the macro, as you've seen yourself, are all starting to come back. So as I said, typhoons are devastating. Yes, I agree totally, but there is life after big devastations. And you know, look at Tacloban. I was here for Yolanda, and the same principle. I mean, we lost all our customers. We were out of but we made up. We diversified again, and all the helpers, all the volunteers that came to Tacloban, we did quite well that year because of that. So, you know, when you look at businesses, and I looked at this thinking for 1 year, thinking, God, what am I going to do? This goes on and on and on, which everyone was probably in the same boat as me. But so I started making the guns, and then I approached the government to do the program for the Crown of Thorning. So, yeah, you use your tools you have and try and diversify to make up for what's missing. So in the second year of the pandemic, and they started to open areas within the Philippines, we did very well with Tacloban and Ormoc. So yeah, we pushed certain products of paddy and so forth, and yeah, we didn't make a lot, but we broke even, and that's all
survived,
that matters.
And you're employing all these locals,
which
is really important.
And that was one of my biggest things, and my wife helps me greatly, Darlene. She's become a very good photographer now, and she does a lot of the Facebook stuff.
I saw her in action. Yes.
I hate Facebook, so I everyone is, well, they're maturing and becoming much better at what they do.
The diversification and the stubbornness and the setting the goals and following ideas.
And achieving things, which is a big thing. I find a lot of Filipinos here very, which is normal, but very tentative and very, oh, I don't know whether I want to do that, and a bit awkward like that. But, you know, I've had guys working for me for years and years, and A, they couldn't speak English, they couldn't drive a car or a truck, couldn't drive a boat, couldn't dive, and now they can do all that. So, you know, it works both ways, I think. And, you know, I can be hard at times, but I'm running the resort, and I look at certain, and one of my biggest things, and Pedro and I are both the same, is we use standards. Paddy standards, the government hotel standards. We stick to the standards. We don't change, because that's one of the big problems in a lot of third world countries, not just the Philippines, but they run it like they run it at their home, and it doesn't work like that.
Yeah, following procedures is not an easy thing. Yeah. Anywhere in the world, actually.
It's very hard. So I try and stick with that, and I, you know, have stock and have everything ready for my customers to enjoy their experience here. And I'm the same. I hate going to places which are rubbish. You just don't want to do it. So we try, and we have around about a 75% return rate on guests. Well, we did pre-pandemic anyway. And a lot of our a lot of our old customers who come every year for many, many years, they've all come and visited us, and that's what we want now, is people, so we can continue on.
Right.
Yeah.
And so let's go diving and see your procedures,
yes.
Right?
Okay, we'll do that tomorrow, yeah. I'll show you what... We take dive crates and we collect corals, and I'll show you what we collect and then what we do with them. There's like lots of things we learn.
Thank you very much, Phil.
That's all
Thank
right.
you.
No problem. My pleasure. Here we are now. I'm diving on a reef here, and I'm collecting corals. I'm collecting hard corals, mostly finger corals. I'm not much of a scientist, but I collect lots of these small green corals. I look for the colourful ones. The ones that are white are usually dead, so don't collect them. That's a bit silly. What I do here is I collect them, And yeah, I move these to a holding area outside my reef, and I replant them later on. I'm collecting more corals here, and I'm banging away. I'm not actually killing the coral. I'm breaking off bits that are disease-ridden. I normally try and take a clean coral, or if I see a little bit of greenness, I take the greenness and leave the dead coral or the diseased coral. So I'm not being violent or anything, so don't worry. Most of this area was damaged by Odette. My plan, the Typhoon Odette, which has devastated a lot of areas, 0 to 5 metres in a lot of dive site areas. This one was lucky, so we're pretty much collecting corals here. And as I said, all these aren't connected at all, they're just lying there, and then we move them to a special site. Here I'm demonstrating how I plant corals here. I put them in nooks and crannies, holes, anything I can find. I wedge them in so they're firm, and there's usually a click. You notice how I tap the coral after I've finished to make sure it's firm. That's just little things I do to keep the corals nice and firm. If they're loose, they won't survive. Normally they die eventually from the movement of the current or the waves. So yeah, that's quite an important thing. I collect these and then I find new holes and put them. Normally, as I said, I collect first and then I plant. Here I am still planting.
gardening,
underwater gardening, I call it. And as I said, this isn't different corals for different things. You'll see me planting other corals, but I find that these harder corals are much better to put a base down, and these are very slow growing too, extremely slow. But they start to green up the holes and the whiteness where it's all been ripped out, so it's a good coral. Yes, I'm looking at corals here. Again, I'm cutting out the disease from the coral with the hammer. I know it's a scary looking thing, but you'll see when I put them in there, they're not too bad. But like, disease is a big thing on coral. There's all sorts of diseases, many sorts, but I try and cut them out wherever I can. Similar to gardening, the same principle. You see something that's not good, you cut it out, and hopefully the plant will survive. So that's the reason why I'm doing this. So putting all this program together that I've been doing, and hopefully it will last, we collect the corals, you see, and then we plant them. And we try and do areas. We're going to use an area out the front of my resort, because it's easy for me to do it all, considering I'm doing most of it. So I'll benefit from it, but all the other people will benefit from it too. It's a marine protected area. But anyway, so the program is, and the more we can get this organized, and what I'm doing logistically now is collecting corals and planting them, but mostly collecting, and then when we get enough people or volunteers, we're going to plant whole areas. I'm planning up to 20 or 30,000 corals to be planted by the end of the year. Well, that's my goal anyway. Hopefully we'll get there. So that's pretty much it. Okay, come and visit us.
Thank you.